really falls in line with what we want to discuss today, Luke, the 22nd chapter. Verse 31. Luke, the 22nd chapter, verse number 31. Luke, the 22nd chapter, verse number 31, for the time that is ours to share. From the New International Version of the Bible, you shall find these words. Simon, Simon, Satan has asked to sift all of you as wheat. But I have prayed for you, Simon, that your faith may not fail. And when you have turned back, strengthen your brothers. Now, God, let the words of my mouth and the meditations of our collective hearts be acceptable in thy sight. O Lord, you are our strength and you are our Redeemer. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. But the time that is ours to share, I just want to encourage the body of Christ. We've still got work to do. We've still got work to do. My brothers and my sisters in Christ, as we look at this particular passage of Scripture, we find ourselves looking at what is called Passion Week, which is the last week of Jesus' earthly existence. And this is, these events particularly happen on Thursday. Let the church say Thursday. Now, you know, in today's time, we usually look at Wednesday as hump day, right? Wednesday is that day, amen, that you know everything that could go wrong, amen, it would go wrong on Wednesday. Amen. We have little jokes and we have little things that we say about Wednesday and about how it is difficult to get over, get to the hump so we can get over the hump. But you see, as we look at this text from today, amen, for Jesus, amen, Thursday, amen, was really, it was after the hump. But it was still a whole lot of mountains that he still had to face within this one day in his life. Look at the original setting of this passage. The original setting of this passage was the upper room. Y'all remember Mahalia Jackson? She said, in the upper room with Jesus. And it was in the upper room that Jesus had the Last Supper with his disciples. But you see, before they could even go to Friday, there was something that happened. Because two of his disciples began to argue about who was going to be the greatest in the kingdom of God. But then he had to resolve that particular disagreement and to let them know that the first will be last and the last will be first. And that if anyone decided or wanted to be great, would they be able to drink of the cup that Jesus was preparing to drink from? You see, church, when Jesus talks about the cup that he had to drink from, it was more than just, you know, a regular coffee cup or a regular tea cup. It was more than just a 32-ounce gulp, amen, that you would get from the Speedway. But Jesus said, are you willing to drink from the cup in which he was getting ready to drink from? For Jesus, that cup, amen, was a metaphor, amen, for something even greater. That cup was a metaphor for pain. That cup was a metaphor for degradation. That suffering, that cup was a metaphor for suffering. And yes, that cup was a metaphor for death. In other words, what Jesus was saying to the disciples, name, Jesus. Your ace of the Lord, their ride or die is getting ready to die. And he says, do you not realize what is getting ready to happen? And so once he gets through dealing with that, then he has to have a little conversation with Peter. And you see, of all of the disciples in the Bible, I'm not sure which one I would be most like, but I do like Peter the most. I like Peter because Peter was what you see is what you hear. Peter didn't know how to put on airs for anybody. Amen. It's one of the things. If his enemy's going to come out of him, he will say it if it's right, and he'll say it if it's wrong. And so here is Peter. The Bible describes him as Simon. Amen. Simon. Amen. He was later given the name Peter. Amen. And Matthew, the 16th chapter. Amen. Because it was at that period where Jesus began to ask the disciples, said, well, who do men say that I am? In other words, he was saying, amen, what is the word on the street? What's the gossip about me? And so they said, well, you know, some people say that you are Elijah. Some people say that you're one of the prophets. But he said, well, who do you say I am? And then here is Peter. Said, you are the Christ, the Son of the living God. He says to him, Peter, which means rock, upon this rock, I'm going to build my church. It is upon that revelation. It was upon that illustration, that illumination. It was upon that confession that I am going to build my church. The church is built on the revelation that Jesus is the Son of the living God. And it says, not only am I going to build my church on that rock, amen, but the gates of hell shall not that he said. But you see, that same Peter, is now being addressed in Luke, the 22nd chapter. And he says, Simon, Simon, Satan has asked to sift you all as wheat. Now you see, people get that mixed up because, amen, they get so concerned, they get so worried because they say, well, the devil wants to sift us as wheat. But one thing about it is that sifting is necessary to separate the good from the bad. You get what I'm saying? And so many times we get concerned about the test. We get concerned about the trial. We get concerned about the tribulation. But have you ever thought about it? Promotion never comes without the proper testing. Ooh. If I could jump, I would jump. If I
sifting.
what's on both sides of the equation. On one side, there is the devil, who is just asking to sift us as wheat. In other words, that was a test that was getting ready to happen anyway. The only thing that Satan asked to do was just to give us the test a little bit early. Then on the other side, here you have Jesus that says, I have prayed for you. But then when I begin to look at what's on the left side, and I begin to look at what's on the right side, I conclude within my mind that this is really not a fair comparison. Because my Bible says that if God be for us, if the Lord be for us, then who can be against us? In other words, I'm glad today that when Jesus says, I have prayed for you, Jesus says, regardless of what the enemy desires to do to you, Jesus says, I've canceled it out because I've already prayed for you. Whatever the enemy wanted to do to harm you, Jesus already said, I have prayed for you. Somebody ought to shout glory. So somebody might say, hey, well, Pastor Messick, why did Jesus pray? Couldn't Jesus have done something else? If he is as much God as you can put in one clump of human flesh, why did Jesus pray? Why didn't Jesus just speak the word? Why didn't Jesus just tell the devil to go back to hell? Because Jesus, if you ask me, I mean, why Jesus prayed, I would submit the following. Jesus had to set an example on earth for his disciples, not just in this situation, but he had to set an example for his followers in the generations to come. In other words, Jesus had to say, you know what? If prayer works for me, then prayer will work. Somebody ought to shout glory right there. In other words, what Jesus was saying is that regardless of what may come and regardless of what may go, if you learn how to use this powerful tool called prayer, prayer will get you out of whatever the enemy tries to get you into. I want to get a witness, somebody. I wonder, is there anybody here that you ever had the church of God in prayer? My God. So pray, 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 pray. In the Bible, you see many different types of prayer. In the Bible, you see many different forms and variations of prayer. Amen. But in this text, amen, I would submit today that this prayer is in essence, even though you do not see the words, amen, it says that he prayed that his faith may not fail. So in other words, this is not a prayer for deliverance, but it is a prayer for endurance. Let the church say endurance. Because what endurance says is that you are in the midst of a fight. You are in the midst of a race. And endurance says you can't give up. Endurance says you've got to keep on going. Endurance says you cannot throw in the towel. Endurance says that there is a season and a time. It's not your season to give up. It's not your season to give in. So Jesus prayed for Simon that his faith may not fail. Because in this life, there are a whole lot of things that will fail. Who will be your friend on Monday? one thing I like about it. Because many times we try to hold on to things and people that God says, you better let them folks go. You get what I'm saying? Because what Jesus says is, at the end of the day, Simon Peter, I pray that your faith will not fail you. Because if you are still yet holding on, it doesn't matter what's falling all around you. Because the same God that brought those friends, he'll bring you some more friends. The same God that brought that paycheck, he'll bring you another paycheck. The same God who brought this, he's able to do it again. I want to say, anybody here to say, I'm so glad he'll do it again. He'll do it again, he'll do it again, he'll do it again, he'll do it again. And so, look at the last point that I want to make in this text, and then I'm going to get somewhere and sit down. He said, number one, that my prayers are greater than the devil's sifting. Number two, he says, that in the midst of that sifting, a whole lot of stuff may fail, but your faith won't fail. But then I want you to get the last point. Because this last point is something every time I read this passage, every time I hear it preached, or every time I preached it myself, I get more happy down in my soul. Because he says, regardless of everything else that has failed around you, he says your faith will not fail. But get this, it says, the thing that I like about this text is that it says regardless of how far you go, you are coming back. And somebody didn't get it. I get that right here. In other words, he says to us that regardless of where you are now and regardless of where you have come from, amen, as it relates to your relationship with God, your comeback is guaranteed. That regardless of what the enemy has told you, regardless of what people have told you, regardless of what friends might do, people might talk about you, people might scandalize your name, people might call you everything but a child of God, what he says is that your comeback is guaranteed. And in this life, there are many people who give us guarantees. But you see, one thing about it is that those guarantees are sometimes not worth the paper that they're written on. Because you can get a guarantee that your car will not fail. But then you have to go to the car dealership and tell them, you promised me that my car will not fail, and now you got to fix it. People might make you all types of promises, but those promises sometimes are not good. But one thing about it is that Jesus says that whenever I make a promise to you, you can take that thing to the bank, and you can guarantee, you are sure that it shall come to pass. And so, Jesus says, life are only temporary, but it is only making us ready for even greater things which are to come. Goodbye, church, and fare you well. Greater is on the way. Little Creek, over the past year, we've gone through the going through. We've been through the flood and we've been through the fire. But the Lord says, greater is on the way. We've been through individually and we've been through collectively. But our comeback is on the way. Some people have come and some people have gone. But guess what? Greater is on the way. And if you are ready for greater, just shout hallelujah. So today, if there be one that does not have a personal relationship with a personal God, we invite you to come. If you do not have a relationship with God, those who know how to pray, I want you to pray. And if you want to make Jesus your choice, as we're standing, I want you to come. This is the day, this is the hour for God to meet you at that place, to meet you in the place where you are. Perhaps you're being sifted as wheat even right now. Jesus desires to meet you right there. One thing is that Peter did deny Jesus, even though he was given the warning. He did deny Jesus. But guess what? He was able to come back. Today, as we stand to our feet, if there is one that does not have a church that you call home, and you desire to unite or reunite with this Little Creek UAFWB Baptist Church, we invite you to come. Whosoever will, let them come. God bless you. You might be seated.